Wow. Listen, this is our first time back in action, and we're doing it in a big way. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm so happy that you're here, whether you're listening to this now or if you're hearing this at a later point. It is Sunday. It is February 6th. And yes, you know, depending on where you are, it might be 3 p.m. if you're on the West Coast. It might be 6 p.m. if you're on the East Coast. It's Dilla time. That's what is really happening right now. So change your watches, adjust your clocks. It is absolutely Dilla time. And we are thrilled to be back with episode 115 of The Questions. Not 215, but 115. And we are here as part of Dilla Week. Shouts to the people at Dilla Fest as well as Fusicology. And man, I am excited for what we have in store today. We are welcoming two guests to the show, and this is a celebration of all things J Dilla. Our very special guest who is joining us for the first time is an author. He is a music professor at NYU. He has years of stories and experiences that we're not even going to be able to get into today because it would be too much. We're not Questlove Supreme. I can't do 6 hours with this man as much as I would like to. But he is the author, and I'm going to, you know, do one of many plugs that we'll be doing today, of an amazing book that you may have heard about. It's making its rounds. I've been plugging this book like it's my own. It is the incredible J Dilla, the last book that will need to be written on the GOAT producer. It's Dilla time. I want everybody to give a warm welcome to our special guest for episode 115, Dan Charnas.
Wow.
Dan.
Wow. Hello.
Hello, Dan. Man, like, Dan, it's been such a crazy week. And, you know, for everybody who's been interested in this book, you know, since the first whispers of it, people who have gotten, you know, advanced copies, to the people who are actually holding this book and reading it for the first time, the feedback is amazing. And, you know, you're going to get your flowers here, as we're giving flowers for Dilla, but we also have to acknowledge all the hard work and the attention that you put into this thing. So thank you so much and welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm a fan of this show. Like I said, little scared because now we got to put all this stuff here to the test. See if it's still in there. But I'm just honored to be here.
Amazing. Well, thanks so much. And shout out to everybody who's joining us on Hopin. Shout out to Hopin, our first time using this amazing platform. Did you guys see that intro? Like, we're official. Like,
incredible.
So, Dan, I know you mentioned that you're a little nervous, and I understand why. Most people get nervous. I was just watching the countdown, and I was getting a little nervous. So it definitely happens, but I want to let you know that you're not dealing with this on your own. Like, you have actually a secret ace in the hole, and I'm thrilled to be welcoming another person to the show. He is not only a former guest, he has been in the hot seat that you are in right now, so mm-hmm. he might be able to commiserate with you a bit. He is also a luminary of Detroit's hip-hop scene. You know, if there were, I'm basically going to be sitting here with two J Dilla historians, because he has been there for so many moments, pivotal music history moments of J Dilla and hip-hop as we know it. He's one half of Frank-N-Dank. He has been involved in so many people and so many, you know, contributors to the music scene. He has either been there with, you know, in the sessions with them. He's collaborated with them. He is a producer. He's an MC. And, you know, he's a friend of the show. So I want you all to welcome our co-host slash, we'll call it the J Dilla lifeline for you today, Dan. Make some noise for Frank Nitt.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. How y'all doing today? Dan, I got you, buddy. You're not alone. You are not alone.
I'm saying I'm just he's the expert. I'm the student. So student is you know, up to the test.
Is that like he's the DJ, I'm the rapper? Is that the same thing?
That's exactly what that is.
Okay.
Somebody with design skills, please get your Photoshop on and make that album mock-up cover. We want Dan and Frank. Frank, you know, you were on the show quite a while back. It was in 2020, I believe.
Yeah, pre-pandemic, yes.
Yes, or sort of in that thick of it. And the last show that we did in real life was a J Dilla-themed show at Delicious Pizza in in Mid City, and that was you know, that was the last real thing that we did before life changed. So it's so great to be back with you here. And you also were on the show once we switched to the live stream format. So do you have any words of advice for Dan today?
Dan, you'll be okay. You know, keep your humor hat on, and you know, yeah, you'll be fine. You'll be fine. It's not that bad. Sean's great. He's great.
Listen, all I got to do is beat my downstairs neighbor, Operator M's, and I feel like, you know,
okay. All right. You're going to do all right, Dan.
Shout out to Operator M's.
Operator M's.
And let me just say also, to touch on what Frank has said, not that bad is the standard by which I've always strived for with the show. So as long as we can say that this was not that bad, I know that we've done our job.
No, I mean, not that bad just connotates that it might get a little rocky. It might get a little, you know, topsy-turvy there, but you'll be all right. You'll be all right. That's what I'm saying.
Frank, I don't know if you're helping or hurting here. Shout out to everybody in the chat. I also want to say, listen, we're going to be talking about this a lot. And yes, this is, you know, this is going to be a J Dilla themed game. But our main attraction today is the Dilla Time book. And we will be doing a drawing at the end of the episode. If you are here in the chat, we're going to be selecting somebody and they will be getting a free copy of Dilla Time that Dan is going to sign with perhaps that marker that he's holding right now, waving it. So, Dan, you know, obviously you've been doing press all week, and I've been thinking, you know, I don't want to ask you like the same questions that everybody's been asking you as it comes to the book, but I just want to ask, like, you know, how does it feel to have this out right now? Like, how many years did you spend writing this book?
It's about 4 years. Yeah. And it feels great. I mean, this is like, you know, after a long journey through the wilderness, it's nice to, you know, come out into, you know, and see, I say it's like rowing a boat alone across the ocean, and then you finally see the shore ahead of you, and then there's friendly people on the far shore. So it feels great. But I again, it's really just, it makes me the happiest to see people talking about James Yancey in elevated ways, in different ways, in ways that put him where he needs to be in history, which is not just in hip hop, but music in general.
Yeah. And, you know, if, for those who don't know, like, not only this serves so many purposes, it's, you know, it's a bio for sure. It's a musicology book because it does explore the impact that James Yancey had on, you know, sort of landscape of music as we know it. There's just so many facets of it, and I'm really excited to get into it. So, you know, I think we should hop into this. So, Dan, I want to kind of go over some guidelines here for you. As Frank said, it gets a little topsy, a little turvy, you know, but you're not alone, because not only do you have Frank, who we have consulted with the official judges of the questions, you will be able to use your Frank lifeline once per round, but also you have our chat here. The chat is always around. Now, I, you know, this is a hop-in crowd. It might be a little bit different than what we've done in the past, but the chat is always enthusiastic. I cannot always vouch for the fact that the chat is correct, but they're there to help you, and you can, you know, take it with a grain of salt. You can be like, okay, this is what the chat is saying. So, you know, you've got options here. I don't want you to feel like you're going up, you know, one man against the world here.
Right. All right. Okay. Okay. You know, because I know watching Amir do this, like he didn't want to look in the comments at all.
Right. When we had Questlove on the show back for episode 50, he was a little reluctant. And there's sort of two schools of thought. There are some people who are like, yeah, you know, it takes a village. You know, we're going to do this as a community. And others who are like, nah, fuck it. I'm doing solo dolo. And if I can't do this on my own, then what good am I? So we don't judge.
It doesn't suffer. that's the thought behind that. Is do it by myself, the village won't suffer.
Exactly.
Unless I get it right, and then everybody wins.
Look, I love that.
There's a lot of different schools of thought that you can approach. Let's get into it. Can we show our very cool, awesome first round video that we have now? Can we? I think we're gonna hop into that. is yours, which is our first round. This is our general multiple choice. So we're going to hop right into it. Question number one. Here we go. James Yancey first learned how to make beats on this sampler. Was it the SP-1200, the MPC-60, the MPC-2000, or the MPC-3000?
Well, I know the answer to this question, but I will say he made a lot of his first beats that we know professionally, right? Like Running by the Far Side, Drop, on an SP-1200. And as Frank will tell you, it wasn't his SP-1200, it was DJ Head's SP-1200. But he learned to make beats. Well, he made beats before he went to Amp's Basement, but he didn't do it on, you know, fantastic professional equipment. But the piece of equipment that he learned on was MPC-60.
Let's see if he's right, folks. The MPC-60 is correct. Look, this is interesting because, Dan, you know, what a lot of people might not know about you is that you've made some beats as well in your day.
I've made some. Yes, some.
And Frank, while you are renowned as a rapper, you're also a bit of a beat maker as well.
Yes, I do dabble in that lane. Yes, I do.
And if I could so humbly throw myself into the mix here, not only am I a host of this show, but your boy also gets a little busy with the beats as well.
Yeah, so, I know that.
So, you know, I guess my question to you first, Dan, is sort of, As a beat maker and as somebody who sort of had, you know, a lot of knowledge about this, not just coming from a straight academic place, was there anything in writing the book that you were sort of surprised to learn about J Dilla on the technical side?
Oh, I mean, everything he did is sort of surprising. I think the thing about James was that he was so free in everything he did. And I don't mean like free, like turning off quantization, which is something he did, but it ain't the only thing he did. You know, Frank's here. Let Frank tell you what this man would do.
I mean, in what context? I mean, you know, like if we just talking musically, like, you know, he was just, he's very, how do we say, what's the word I'm looking for? It's like, once he pinpoints something, he's meticulous at whatever that one thing is. And everything around him kind of melts away and he kind of focuses on this one thing. So like when it came to making beats and like just the way he listened to records and his memory was, you know, I have no idea how he remembered the things. And it would be Frank, like, you know, this instrument played in this record and he'll go back 10 days later and go to that instrument type of thing. You know what I mean? Yes.
You told a great story about James searching for open places on records. And that was like a revelation for you watching him in that process.
Yeah. No. We were in the basement. He had a beat. And the beat in my mind was done. But, you know, he kept listening to this one record that he had took pieces from. And he's like, Frank, I'm listening to this record. I'm asking him, like, why have you listened to this record 100 times? Like, he said, because it's in there. There's a little piece, and it's a second long, 2 seconds long that I need, and it's in there. And at some point, I'm going to find it, but I just got to keep listening because it's way in the back somewhere. And he was just meticulous like that, where the beat wasn't finished till he went and found this one little second little piece to complete it in his mind. In my mind, I could have rapped to it right now, and we can get on going. But for him, and he's listened to this record 100 times, but he's going to find it because it's some obscure note or something behind the vocals, behind the drums, behind the dude playing the horn, and this the sax player hit this note that's the turnaround that he needs to finish his beat. And he gonna find it, but he would stick to it like that. So again, like Dan said, it's a lot of intricacies to how he finessed music.
Frank, is there a beat that you were, having witnessed the creation of so much of the music, is there a beat that just on a technical level, like really impressed you or impresses you today, that like knowing the source and sort of seeing how it was flipped and sort of recreated, is there one that comes to mind that it is sort of, there's so many that you could say.
Yeah. For Virginia, I mean, obviously like Questlove talks about the little brother
by Black Star.
Yeah. Yeah. He talks about that flip. And also the common joint, I think it was Cold Blooded. He flipped,
like Water for Chocolate.
Like Water for Chocolate. Like, doing it. For me, I watched him make Breathe and Stop. And the original Breathe and Stop was made up of a bunch of little pieces from a record. And it was like when he was putting it all together and playing. Like, I literally asked him, like, what were you thinking? Like, these little, because it's made up of a bunch of little bitty stabs. And he made it from this record from all these different little places. And just like, yo, I took this and that and that, all that. And it was just like, yo, like, what is wrong with you, man? Like, and you know, he just laughed. It was just funny to him. But like, Breathe and Stop is just one of the beats, because I actually watched him make it. I seen him make it and heard all the pieces and all these different things. And my thought was like, why did you use that? What were you thinking to use just this little thing here? Because, you know, I was trying to break it down. Yeah. Yeah, all that was like pieces.
Wow.
Pieces.
Wow.
And it's just, yeah, yeah. That's how I felt. That's how I felt.
There's a lot of wow moments when breaking down the catalog here. Guys, everybody who's watching, don't forget, we have a Q&A tab. So if you guys have questions for either Dan or Frank, if we have some time at the end, we'll get into it. So, you know, you guys are a part of this too. We appreciate you for all tuning in today on this Sunday. Okay, we're going to keep moving because, look, this is going to be the hardest challenge of this broadcast, this episode. We can go down, I mean, Dilla Time is a deep dive down the rabbit hole, but there's so many side rabbit holes that I know we're going to go in. Justin, the folks at Hoppin, I'm sorry I said this was going to be an hour. This might be a little bit longer, but we're going to do our best to keep it to time. So we're going to move on to our next question. Doing good so far, Dan. Question number two. In 2007, DJ Spinna collaborated with this vocalist for the Dilla medley homage called Diligence. Was it Bilal, Busta Rhymes, Fonte Coleman, or Illa J?
Well, let's do some deductive reasoning here.
So I love that. Love that.
Obviously, the first collaboration that John Yancey, aka Illa J, made with his brother was the 2009, if I'm not mistaken, album Yancey Boys. So that would have been after that. There was a Busta Rhymes. There was a Busta Rhymes mixtape, right, called Diligence. Mm-hmm. And I do know that DJ Spinna did that beat, but that beat existed before Busta Rhymes mixtape. It was actually put out on a 45. Actually, before it was put out on a 45, it was just a file that was circulated on the internet. All you crazy OK Player people. Okay Players, and it was an Okay Player who collaborated with DJ Spinna in 2007 on the original version of Diligence, and that was C. Fonte Coleman.
Fonte Coleman is correct. I love how you broke that all down too. Because yes, that Diligence was the name of the Busta Rhymes project for sure, and I love that one as well. It was cool to, you know, hear a lot of those beats get used, and obviously Busta and Dilla have a lot of, you know, history together. But yes, Fonte, and I love this song. I love the homage, and I love, you know, the way that it weaved in so many, you know, sort of references and tributes to the Dilla catalog.
Super brilliant, super brilliant. You know, and it's really a tribute. Like it's taking the source material, but mixing it and putting it together in a way that brings forth the genius of Spinna and Tay. So, yeah.
Yeah. There's obviously been a lot of there's been a lot of releases that have come out, and a lot of people sort of started hopping on a lot of these beats, either in an official or an unofficial capacity. So, you know, it's been interesting to watch that happen. By your guys' you know, Frank, I want to know, like, from your sort of perspective, what is your feeling on that as it's happened? I feel like that it must have, there must have been sort of like an emotional roller coaster here of like how there was definitely around this time where like everybody started hopping on these Dilla beats. Like, from your perspective, you know, how did you sort of feel about that?
You know, like you said, it's kind of an emotional roller coaster. Part of me, you know, the friend side of me, the protective homeboy side of me, you know, everybody back up, don't touch nothing. But the businessman, the adult Frank understands growth, and there's pain in that. So, like, we're not standing here having the conversations we're having without that. Mm. It added to the mystique. It added to his greatness in a lot of ways, because so many people who weren't connected and, you know what I'm saying, were eager to have that connection. So again, part of me is elbows out, everybody back up, man. But on the flip side, I understand growth. I understand that, you know, his legacy deserves a nice seat so everybody can see it. And it takes these type of things to achieve that a lot of times. So I'm balanced somewhere in the middle there. You know what I mean?
Totally. I love that. That's a great take on that.
Great.
Shout out to Fonte, former guest of the show, friend of the show. Obviously, Dan, you've worked with Fonte quite a bit. You guys worked on The Breaks.
Yep, right there.
That's right, guys. He's not just an author. This is somebody who has worked in television. You know, big shout out to The Breaks on VH1.
He's a Renaissance man.
He's a Renaissance man.
A classic man.
He can break dance too.
Oh, hell no.
Well, that's why they called it The Breaks, right? I heard the original title sequence had Dan just getting busy.
Yes.
Yeah.
He was on. He had his floor game on top. Like he's.
Dan's like, wrap the bit up, guys. The bit is not working.
All right.
We're going to move
on. I will say this because this is a Fonte thing as well. We did not have a theme song for The Breaks because we needed to preserve time. But DJ Premier, who was our executive music producer, did a flip of Impeach the President that is so unbelievable as the theme song that we never used. When Fonte first heard it, Fonte said he wanted to throw his phone across the street.
Yeah.
I'm like, offline, I will play it for you.
Incredible. Oh, my God. Mm. Wow. Yeah, that sounds good. Oh, crazy. All right, we're going to move on to question number three. Doing great so far, Dan. This is your I hope your fears are starting to fade a bit.
I don't know. Might catch me slipping.
All right. Question number three. Which of these Slum Village albums was the first to not include production from Dilla? Was it A, Trinity, Past, Present, Future? B, Detroit Deli, A Taste of Detroit? C, the self-titled Slum Village? Or D, Villa Manifesto?
Well, you know, James produced two albums in whole for Slum Village. It was fantastic. Right. It wasn't even volume one. It's just fantastic. Issued on El Azim Wajid and Donut Boy Recordings, dubbed on cassette at the Kinko's somewhere, in Royal Oak or something. And then sold around Detroit and then distributed to people like Q-Tip and, you know, Amir. And that's how this whole legend started. It was a real group effort, QD and borrowed one of James' dubbing decks, and he dubbed the cassettes at his own place, you know, on blank cassettes, and they put the labels on, the stickers on themselves. So, Frank was there, right? The second album was Fantastic Volume 2, which they recorded in 98 and then released in 2000. But by the time it was released, James had already sort of said goodbye to Slum. He just wanted to do his own thing. And that's a whole other discussion, but really important to understanding what made him tick. And the first Slum album after that departure was Trinity, A. And so that did have some JD tracks on it, but I do believe it was the first Slum Village album to not include which of these Slum Village, I'm misunderstanding the question. Which of these Slum Village albums was the first to not include any production by Dilla?
That is correct.
Oh, shoot. Oh, do I know which came first?
I thought you were taking us on a long walk.
It's again, reading comprehension. C or D? It's C or D. Let's see.
Pulling out the stumpers here.
I am going to say that the Slum Village album came after Villa Manifesto. I don't know why I'm saying that, but I think that is the case. So I'm going to guess that it's D.
Okay, so your final answer, you're going with Villa Manifesto as the first album that did not feature J Dilla production. Want to make sure that we're clear here.
Uh-oh.
All right. This is the moment of truth here. I'm going to pull this up.
Uh-oh.
The Slum Village album, the self-titled album, came out in 2005 and was the first to not feature J Dilla production. So the answer was C. Villa Manifesto came out a few years later and actually feature the song Lock It Down, as well as a few other J Dilla beats. Dan, I mean, listen, this we're not going to dwell on this here, but a lot of these releases got a little crazy. The chronology gets a little mixed up.
I'm going to have to call RJ Rice tonight and apologize. I might have apologized to T3 too. Wow. Okay. Yeah.
Look, if there's anything that we, stress here is that even our super hip hop brainiac geniuses are human. And, I also want to say that what was interesting about the book, and especially particularly the focus on the group dynamic in Slum Village amongst its members, is that you weren't really afraid to tell a lot of sides and show a human side to, the dynamics that were playing amongst the group members. It was interesting to me to read about the transformation. And, to be honest, it gave me a lot of appreciation for a guy like T3 who really was committed to steering the ship in throughout situations where it would have been perfectly acceptable to be like, oh, you know what? Let's hang it up. And he's definitely stayed the course. Can you speak a little bit more? I'd like to hear, Dan, from you, what it was like sort of unraveling more about the group dynamic of Slum Village in, researching and writing this book.
Oh, man, it's hard to do it with two of the original, the troika that we know, right? Two of them are not with us anymore. So I relied heavily on Three for a lot of that, a lot of that dialogue. But also it's important to remember that Wajid and QD were also early members of Slum Village, and I think always crew. So it was helpful, to kind of get their input too. And also, the business folks, right? That's how I always look for the business folks around a group, because they know stuff. They observe how things work, and they're sometimes a little more neutral. So RJ Rice and Tim Maynor were also super helpful in trying to tell that story. But I hope that people really get from this book that T3 has a genius that's all his own. Batin, obviously, as well, but they were all on this rhythmic mission together. Their cadences were unique. Nobody else sounded like them in hip hop. And
amazing. Well said. All right, we're gonna move on to question number four, final question in our first round here. And the question is, which of these rappers' voices does not appear on the J Dilla Donuts album? Is it A, DMC, B, Jadakiss, C, Mad Skills, or D, Pasta Noose? Dan, we had to turn up the heat. We had to turn up the heat. But remember, again, you might be on that Questlove solo dolo tip, but we got Frank Nitt and we've got the chat in here. If you're starting to feel that you might want to, reach out to the resources here.
All right. Well, of course, Jadakiss is definitely on there, right? I believe that Skills is on there. I don't recall hearing DMC and Pause the News on there. So automatically my mind goes to A or D, but I want to ask if Frank will give me a hint.
Remember, Dan, I told you at some point it's all in the music mm-hmm. when it came to relationships and things like that.
Right.
It was all in the work.
Right.
I'll give you that tidbit. That should lead
what he thinks. Yeah. So there's you know, we're in slippery territory here. You know, Frank is also a bona fide Dilla head, but you know, it could go either way.
Yeah, it's only what I think.
It's very cryptic. I love his hint because it's such a, you know, I love his hint.
But, I want to see, can we bring in, I want to see what the chat is saying. Maybe we could bring in some of the chat here. Okay. So, Zuri says A, Kyle Means thinks it's D. Dom Synchro says D. Shout out to Dom Synchro. We've got a mix of A and D, which isn't really helping you because that's what you already said.
Well, if I'm going to take Frank's hint, I'm going to interpret his hint to mean that he had, it's all in the music, it's all in the relationships. And he had a relationship with Pause the News. Mm. He had a relationship with Skills. And I know that JDK is on there. So I'm going to guess again that it's DMC's voice that does not appear on Donuts and hope for the best.
All right, we're going to actually do a little bit of an audio journey here to see the answer. So first up. Of course, Jadakiss was on there, so we can eliminate that. Second up, we've got this rap game. That was the Razzcast and Mad Skills joint. So Mad Skills is on there. All right, this is the moment of truth. Check this out. Now that sounds a little crazy. But I have it pulled up here. This is the that little vocal sample. This is what that is from.
All right. Check this out.
Check this
one,
out.
1, 2, 3, in the place to be, as it is plain to see. He is DJ Run, and I am DMC. Funky fresh for DMC.
I said, listen. I said all in the music to lead you to Pasta News because Posse had a relationship with. He didn't have a relationship with DMC.
All right.
It was the opposite of it. It was the opposite of it.
You know, but of course now, you know, hearing that, like, of course, like, damn it. All right.
Mm-hmm. Listen, we're not gonna join.
Isn't that your Twitter handle, as a matter of fact? Is that what causes that, Sean? Damn it.
Yes. It was a mix of that and also being tired of people not being able to pronounce my last name. So I would just say Sean, damn it. So it has its roots in a few different things. Dan, like we're not going to dwell on this. And I know maybe it stings a little bit because you've got some Priority Records history and like Priority, Run DMC, you know, this is your life profile. Yeah. Man, now I'm screwing up. This is coming off the wheels here. It's getting topsy turvy, like Frank had said it would. But we're not gonna dwell on this because there's many more wins to have. So I think we're ready to move on to our second round. We've done the multiple choice, and now we're moving into our visual round, and that round is called Picasso Baby. All right, so this is the visual round, and basically how this goes is I'm going to show you a very cropped piece of an album cover, and you have to let me know what the album is by the little piece of it that you see. Okay. We're going to also put this out as audio only, so I'd love for you to sort of tell me visually what you're seeing before you answer the question, you know, sort of to play for our non-visual audience later.
I like that.
This is called producing live on the air, you know, like could have done this earlier, but we were geeking out over Dilla shit. So here we go, hopping right into it. Question number five. What album is this? Is it Mocha Only, The Desired Effect, Doom, Born Like This, The Roots, Game Theory, or is it Common, Finding Forever?
Well, what I'm looking at is a stick figure with some typewritten words over top of it, and that is I hate to use this word. I tell my students not to use this in their writing because it's the most overused word in journalism. Iconic. But it is an iconic cover of C, The Roots, Game Theory.
Sky's the limit, it'll take but a minute. Don't fear for your people, nigga.
The Roots, Game Theory is correct, which of course featured the donut that was reused for Can't Stop This, the Roots and Black Thought's tribute to Dilla. I feel like The Roots sort of played a bit of a big part in maybe even the genesis of this book for you, right? Or perhaps one member of said group?
Well, I think Amir Questlove, he was the first person I knew of to articulate, to really advocate for JD's importance as a producer. And he did it on the pages of OK Player. He did it in The Roots liner notes. He did it in person. He was really the first person, I think, to put pen to paper on that particular argument. So every argument that's made on the page thereafter, we all have to tip our cap to Amir because he was the first person to do it. And so all of us, dillologists, if you will, we trace this back to him in many ways.
Absolutely. Frank, do you have any good stories about, Amir or, maybe Tariq coming to Detroit? Were you there for any of those sessions?
pretty much all of them. But anyway, no. I told one in the book, I think it made it, if I'm correct.
The beat battle, right? And then the mom's going to Blockbuster?
Yes. So, and then there's a lot of different stories with the members of The Roots, but in particular that one, Questlove, it was after New Year's Eve, and me and Dilla had went, like Common was in Detroit working with Dilla, and they had a show with Common and The Roots in Chicago on New Year's Eve. So me, Dilla, and the homie Mark D hopped in a van and drove up to Chicago for the show, right? So we did, the show, New Year's Eve, it had cases and cases of champagne on the stage. So crazy night, had a good night. Next day, we going back to Detroit. Questlove says, I'm going with y'all. So he comes back to Detroit. While we're going back, massive snowstorm happens. And Questlove is supposed to fly out of Detroit the next day. Or maybe, I think it was the next day. And his flights got canceled. All flights got canceled, right? So he was stuck in Detroit. And he was like, well, you know what? I don't get no hotel. I'm just going to stay at the studio house, which is Dilla's crib, right? Like the Nevada crib. But Dilla wasn't staying there at the time. But all the records and equipment was there. And he said, I just need some supplies. So at the time, it was still Blockbuster rent movies type thing, right? And I didn't have a Blockbuster card. Dilla didn't have no Blockbuster card. My mama had a Blockbuster card, though. So I loaded up my mama, Questlove, in Dilla's truck. And we went to went to the video spot, and he got a bunch of videos and candies, like movie candies, and all his little supplies, and he bought him some crazy slippers because Questlove wearing the crazy slippers. He bought some crazy slippers and he set up at the crib. My mama had to use her Blockbuster card to get Questlove. And like it's funny now that she's reading the book, like she's like, I didn't have no clue who he was as a musician. I just knew I had to take him to get some movies. So it's dope. Like that's one of the good stories there. Like, that was the relationship that a lot of the artists had, though, to speak further to that, they would come to the D and be there and kind of deal with, the hood politics or whatever it was to be there to get that work. So yeah, Quest got stuck in a snowstorm. We had to go to Blockbuster, get movies, candies, and big old fluffy slippers.
This was prior to Netflix, kids, where it would have been a lot easier,
It would have been a lot easier, and he probably, it's Questlove, so I'm sure he would have had Netflix wired to everything or whatever, today. But then, wasn't like that. Yeah. So, yeah, he had to get set up. And my mom hooked him up. My mom went, shout out to my mom. She went, you know, Blockbuster and made it happen.
Shout out to mom. Lindsay asks, she wants to know what kind of candy. Look, I don't know if Frank has the memory for all the details, but
No. I smoke. Wait. Anyway, I mean, it was like movie candy. So you would think, you know, I don't know, like, I mean, whatever he said, my Butterfingers, and you know what I'm saying? I don't know. I don't know. I don't even remember.
Can we agree that the superior movie theater candy is snow caps? Like, what's your choice?
Especially from Blockbuster, I used to get dots. I used to get the dot, the big box of the dots, and Reese's Pieces. I was a big Reese's Pieces guy.
Dan, you have anything to weigh in on the candy debate here?
I don't. I mean, I'm assuming that James got the Red Vines. He was a big Red Vines person.
He was a Red Vines guy. Yes, he was.
All right. Yeah. We're talking candy here on The Questions with Dan Charnas. If you're just tuning in to our new podcast, Candy Talk.
Yes.
We're going to move on to our next question in the Picasso Baby round. What album cover is this? Is it Common's Electric Circus, Q-Tips Amplified, Frank-N-Dank's 48 Hours, or is it Chino XL's I Told You So?
Oh, Lord have mercy. Well, let's do some deductive reasoning here. It can't be Chino XL's I Told You So, because I know that album cover, and it's Chino lit in flames. This does not look like Common's Electric Circus because it doesn't look like it's an illustrated cover, and that was an illustrated cover. Frank-N-Dank 48 Hours is a very simple, beautiful cover of them sitting, I believe, in a barbershop in New York. Am I wrong about that?
Nope. That's a bootleg cover
of
a photo of us in Toronto. And what they did was took the photo and flipped it reverse. They put me on the other side and put that, because we reversed the original photo was the other way around.
so you were not seated on the Frank side. So they needed to put you on the Frank side. Yeah.
They put me on the Frank side, right? So and because the official 48 Hours is just, you know, gold, a black cover gold font.
I feel like we just solved the mystery here.
Well, yeah, because Q-Tip is playing like he was like, this was his first solo album, so he was like, all my identities. Like, he was trying to find out his identity. So he's like in all these different outfits and stuff, fanned out. And Brian Cross, the same one who took the famous photos of Dilla at Clinton Township. Shout out to B Plus. He also took those photos of Q-Tip for Amplified. So I am going to say that it's B, Q-Tip Amplified.
Q-Tip Amplified is correct. You'd recognize that fur coat anywhere. It's the fur coat that made backpackers weep at that time.
Oh, it's true. So unneed. I know, but it's just like so. It was all bangers.
It was all bangers.
It just really got a raw deal. That's actually one of the stories that we tell in Dilla Time about Clive Davis. Usually shepherded his artists through the promotion process, you know, and he was leaving Arista right at that time. So his A&R person, Drew Dixon, really feels like that album got lost in the sauce, and that Breathe and Stop could have been a bigger hit than it was if it had gotten a little more muscle behind it.
Yeah. Now I got two quick ones for you. Well, actually, I'm gonna tell y'all one quick one because y'all mentioned the fur coat, right? So after Amplify came out, Q-Tip comes into town. He had a show in Detroit or in one of the areas outside of Detroit. And he comes into town and, like, you know, I mean, like, Q-Tip for me is an anomaly when it comes to celebrity, because obviously he's famous, right? But not oversaturated famous. Mm-hmm. But amongst other celebrities, it's like he's even more famous with them. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's crazy. Like, Leonardo DiCaprio is going to love Q-Tip. You understand? So Q-Tip came and he pulled up in a stretch limo and he got out and he had like a fur coat on, but it was full length. Now it's a dead of winter in Detroit, but he ain't got no shirt on. And it was like, he was like a full on star. It was like the craziest thing I ever seen. It was right after Amplify had came out. Like, so yeah, no, the fur coat, It was real. It was real. It was real for folks. If y'all think he was playing, he was not playing. That was full on tip at the show, out the limo before the show with the full length fur with no shirt.
So he was basically doing this. Like he was basically doing the album cover.
Yes, yes. The album cover is real.
Wow. Love that. Love that. Q-Tip is definitely, yeah. Who doesn't love Q-Tip? So again, imagine when he's with the stars, you know.
It's like it's an anomaly because most people in that seat also are very saturated in the media and very, you know what I'm saying? And Tip is not that, but if he feels like he's that when he's in the room, it's crazy.
I just want to say, Sean, this is such a good programming choice to have Frank Nitt on here because it would be so much less interesting with just my ass on here.
Obviously we're happy that Frank's here, but I feel like this would have been just as interesting and we would be going deeper, but you know, we're all sharing the love and the magic here. So it's all good. I'm happy that both of you guys are here and I'm happy that everybody is here watching us on Hoppin. Make sure you hit that Q&A for any kind of questions you want to submit. We'll have some time at the end. We're good. We're good on time right now, right? Everybody's cool. Yeah. All right. Cool. Here we go.
Hey, man, y'all pushing it, man. Y'all pushing it. No, I'm playing.
This guy, you throw him a compliment, and now he's, you know, running such a tight ship.
Where's my sparkling water?
last question of our second round. Here is an image. You have to tell me what the album is. Is it Slum Villages? First, Dan, describe to me what we're seeing here before I go into the choices here.
It is a telephone, an old-fashioned rotary dial telephone, but only the innards, like the dial and then like the innards of the phone, but the phone exterior of the phone, the casing is stripped away.
It's an apt description. So we're keeping it all slum for this one because all the options are Slum Village. So is this image from the album cover for Slum Village's Detroit Deli? Is it Slum Village's Fantastic Volume 1, or just Fantastic as it was called at the time, Fantastic Volume 2, or is it Slum Village's Yes?
I am absolutely sure, reflexively, that this is C, Slum Village Fantastic Volume 2.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know why the fuck.
Volume 2. I don't know. For many. You know, for those of us who were maybe not industry insiders, this was the record that kind of, you know, really caught the attention of the group and you know, JD as the rapper. Incredible. Yeah, I have no other anecdote for that. I mean, like, it is fantastic. What is your favorite song on Fantastic Volume 2, Dan?
Mine?
Yeah,
gun to your head. I mean, it's like who's your favorite child? I don't know. Like, they're incredible. But I think for me, the first one for me, I mean, it's almost like a tie between Players and I Don't Know, because they're just both, they were so, listen, I got a bootleg. I don't know. It's not really a bootleg, more like a demo of this CD from Tim Maynor in early 1999 when A&M had just shut down. And I think they were beginning to shop this around to alternate situations. And I happened to do A&R at the time, believe it or not, for Forrest Whitaker, because Forrest had a label through Sony, and I was sort of the person tapped to run it. We had signed Trey from the Far Side.
Nice.
You know, right when we started. But I remember having this record and hearing Players. I hadn't heard Volume 1 or the first Fantastic, but hearing I Don't Know and Players for the first time, I mean, JD was already a favorite of mine, but this was so above and more creative than anything he had done previously. This was the thing, I think, this was the thing when I turned to Chino, because we were making Chino's second album, Chino XL's second album. I said, we gotta go to Detroit. We gotta go to Detroit. And then we did a few months later in August of 99.
Mm. Wow. Frank, do you have a pick for your favorite song on Volume 2?
No, not even close. But
I respect it.
No, Dan brings up a good point. Those two particular songs are really, really crazy. Players and I Don't Know. But I mean, you know, on Volume 2, you got like the Busta record, and you got, you know, you got the Corrupt record, and then, you know, the Tribe, the Q-Tip record. It's a lot of joints on there, right? Like, so, but I don't know. You know what? I don't know. It's special to me because I remember that original song was only the one verse and chorus. Mm. And it was the label that really, really liked it and said, yo, y'all need to make it longer. And they had to go back and do the second half. Yeah. So I remember that vividly. So I don't know. I don't know about a favorite, but it probably sticks out the most.
And then they got Jeff, Jazzy Jeff, to do the cuts on that.
Yeah.
And you know what's crazy, Sean, is that he did the cuts on that. And this was actually, he heard the initial version of I Don't Know on a bootleg from Japan. Jeff mm-hmm. said he was in L.A. doing his appearances on Fresh Prince. And, you know, he heard it played on the beat or Power 106. And that's what he said. He became a JD fan. But he did not realize at the time that the song was an homage to his song, Brand New Funk, because mm-hmm. that was the first song to intersperse little James Brown samples in it, just like that. And then he ends up doing the cuts on the second version of it.
It's like, a beautiful full circle moment for sure. That's crazy. All right, we're going to move on. Dan, you did very well in the second round. This was your, don't call it a comeback. You've been here for about 55 minutes. So we're going to hop into our third round. And the third round now is going to test your ears. It is our sample round. And the round is called Digging Ooh. In the Crates.
No, I'm not going to.
So this round is pretty simple. I'm going to play you a sample, and you're going to have to answer a question about the sample that you hear. So let's get into it. This J Dilla album features a sample of the Dells. Does anybody know I'm here? So I'm going to play you that Dells sample, and you tell me which album sampled this. This is a J Dilla album. That was the party question. I'm going to play it again. Is it Donuts, Rough Draft, The Shining, or Welcome to Detroit? Play it one more time. What do you think, Dan?
I'm thinking it's either B or C. It very much sounds it. I don't recall that on Donuts or Welcome to Detroit, but it sounds like it might be it sounds like it's something that he might have done on Rough Draft or The Shining, but I'm thinking that kind of loose drumming on The Shining, Kareem did a lot of that. So I don't know. I'm gravitating towards B, Rough Draft, but I know that that Rough Draft is a favorite, significant album or EP to Frank. So I don't know, Frank. Do you have another one of your cryptic hints?
You know what? Like I was gonna say, I'm not gonna be any help in the sample department because you know why with that, right? Like so, but you know, samples.
Let's see what the chat says. Let's see what the chat has to say because I'm seeing a lot of different things in the chat here. So Joey Paul says The Shining. Inca One says Shining. Hip Hop Chronicle. Shout out to Hip Hop Chronicle from Breaking Adam's podcast. He says Shining. Thompson, we're getting a lot of Shining love.
Yeah, I think if Breaking Adam's, you know, that crew is behind The Shining, then I think I'm gonna go with C. The Shining.
All right, I'm going to play that sample one more time and then we're going to go into the actual song that did it. So let's see.
Oh.
The Shining. Over the Breaks.
Right.
this album is special to me. This album is special to me. I was working at a record store when this came out, and we got like an early, like, you know, advanced promo copy, and it just felt like, you know, a meteor had crashed from another planet, and like there was, you know, there was some remnants of like life that we didn't know about. And that one definitely holds a place in my heart.
I love learning about the making of this album. Like, as a student of J Dilla, being able to talk to Kareem about it, being able to talk to J-Rock about it, and knowing how much work James actually put into this in the last year of his life. A lot more work into this than he did to Donuts. Donuts was very much something that was sort of two-thirds of the way complete, you know, by early 2005. But he really was at those sessions with Dave Cooley working on this album. And you probably know the original name of this album, what he was going to call it. Actually, it had two names before The Shining.
Was it ever going to be called J Stay Paid, or am I mixing that up? No.
Think about it. It's the hint is it's BBE, right? So what was his first BBE album?
It was Welcome to Detroit. So right. Was it Welcome to LA?
Yeah, he was going to call it Welcome to LA. And I think it was going to be Welcome Back to Detroit before that.
Ah. So am I correct in understanding that he did the work on this before Donuts?
Frank?
Yeah. Yeah. No, he was working on this. This was like an album he's working on. Frank-N-Dank actually recorded a song for it. But the beat we recorded over, another artist bought the beat. So he had to remix it, and he never got to changing the beat.
What can you tell us, or do you remember what beat it was that you recorded to?
No. Because, I mean, when we got the beat, they didn't get names. You know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
So, and it was a West Coast artist. I want to say J.O. Felony, but not J.O. Felony.
So, and did they actually release the
Yeah, audio, yeah. It came out as a single. Yeah.
Huh. It wasn't Oh No, was it?
It wasn't Oh No. No. It was like not somebody you would think. I can't think of who it was.
All right.
But the artist came out with a record on the beat that we recorded over. So he needed to change it, and he never got to it. So, this was an album. The Shining was an album. It was not like Donuts is, you know, a beat album, which is a little different.
Yeah.
It's kind of singular. It's just kind of him. You know what I mean?
Right. I love The Shining. I think it's so good. I would say I kind of feel like it's a little underrated, I would say, amongst like the Dilla heads.
I mean, and the thing that was crazy to me that I learned from Kareem is that Won't Do and Dime Piece were actually recorded while he was still in Michigan. He said Won't Do was like a full two-track stereo mix right out of his studio in Clinton Township.
Incredible. Wow. Well, we're going to move on to our next question. Shout out to the chat for coming to save the day and, you know, representing here. We're going to move on to question number 9. J Dilla's flip of Aqua Fragile's Cosmic Mind Affair was used on this Busta Rhymes album. So I'll play you the sample. Here we go. No, it's not Lord Have Mercy. It's Busta Rhymes. Different flip mode squad members. Here we go. So here's the sample in question. Is it When Disaster Strikes, Anarchy, Genesis, or It Ain't Safe No More?
Listen, this sample means a lot to me because I have a memory right when I was in the thick of writing this book. I live in Harlem, you know, near 125th Street, and just in the middle of the night, I woke up and this was blasting out of somebody's car. And it was like I rarely hear a Dilla beat blasting out of a car in Harlem. Usually it's either, you know, I don't know, like, you know, the latest fare from a Hot 97, or it's like Anita Baker. but it's C, Genesis.
He says Genesis. Genesis is correct. that's a weird, I mean, look, it's a incredible banger, and it's something that I bang in the car a lot. But again, that's like a strange thing for you to have heard at that time.
2 a.m. It was almost like an omen, a sign, a visitation, like, okay, you know.
Love that. Love that. All right, we're going to move on to our final question in this round. Question 10. Here we go. 1970s singer-songwriter Sean Phillips had a song called I Don't Want to Leave You, I Just Came to Say Goodbye. And it was sampled on a song where Dilla trades rhymes with this artist. So this gets a little tricky. I'm going to play you the sample, and you got to tell me who is rhyming with JD on the song that sampled this. So here we go. Here's the sample. Is it Guilty Simpson, Q-Tip, Madlib, or T3?
Woo! Well, one of my favorite verses from James DeWitt Yancey is on this song. Incredibly clever. Matter of fact, Jazzy Jeff and J Period played it on their Dilla tribute last night. The song is called That Shit, and it's on the Funkmaster Flex third mixtape or whatever. And the MC is Q-Tip. B.
Yo, what's your name, Pop?
It's JD.
And what's the name of your crew?
It's SV.
Yeah, that's Bati and that nigga.
T3.
And yo, tell me where you from.
I'm from the D, y'all.
Yo.
I'm from the D.
Gem.
Incredible. Gem. And it's not available on any streaming service. You can only find it on YouTube. It's a crime that people have not heard this song.
Yeah, there's a few of those that I would say exist in the, you know, JD, J Dilla, you know, catalog, where those need to be, you know, it's such a classic cut. I remember hearing it on the Funkmaster Flex. I think it was like, I don't remember the name, the actual title, but it's Flex. It's a lot of yellow text, like of everybody who's on there. And it said, like, I don't even know, it probably doesn't say JD. It probably just says A Tribe Called Quest is on there. But yeah, that
featuring
was
featuring JD.
Oh, it does say like, yeah, featuring JD on there. Okay, mm-hmm. Great. Yeah. Yeah. Just a classic cut. Are there any, you know, we talked about this one for both of you guys. Is there any like sort of in the cut, Dilla track, whether it's him producing or him rhyming, that you kind of wish got a little more love or a little more spotlight? What's like your kind of like underdog pick, Frank? You got any?
Oh man, all of them, everything. I don't know. You know what? I think the record, the last record they put out for him, The Diary, there's a song on there called Trucks. And I think that if that song would have got the right shine when he made it, though, because he made it obviously when he was alive and everything, he was in a good financial place and all these different things. So it was a different Dilla when he made that record and he was into his trucks at that point. I think that I think that was a really big, that was some Welcome to Miami Will Smith type of big record. I don't know if he would have fit into that mold per se, but I think that was a big record for him.
Dan, do you have any pick for like your sort of underdog, or is it this?
Listen, I say it at the end of the book. It's like that album is like the shoulda, coulda, woulda album. Mm. For me, it's the Kenny Ray, the Diamonds beat. I think Knotts did that beat, like that, and it's a pop song.
Yeah,
it is a pop song.
Diamonds is a huge record too.
Huge. And then this probably would have been more of the mix show song for the hip hop mix shows, but the O, the Creep, you know, it's just too much good stuff. And again, that's one of the hallmarks of my own A&R career is the regret of working on things and either not seeing them come out for one reason or another, or them not doing as well as they could have for one reason or another. And it is, so I think that's one of the reasons that the J Dilla story is evocative for me personally, because it's triggering, you know? I mean, and then of course the Frank-N-Dank, the first version of the Frank-N-Dank album, right? Where's that? Like, that's something we have to hear
I heard some of that recently.
Hey, listen, stay tuned, folks. That's all we can really say. Stay tuned. So listen, and by the way, you know, on the questions, we do these like once a quarter. We try to do like hip hop, like sort of fantasy brackets. And I don't know when we're going to do this. It might be a bit later, but we've been talking about doing a bracket of greatest J Dilla beats. And we have a hard time picking these, but if you think it's an easy task to cut down this man's catalog to 64 picks, like, I don't know how we're going to do it. I know that I'm going to get skewered on the internet because somebody's going to be mad that I left out their favorite song, but we're going to figure it out. So stay on the lookout for that.
Guys, you know what? If you want to figure that out, you're going to have to put more parameters on top of it.
I know.
It's going to be the 64 tracks he produced for other artists. Like,
right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it can't be just all time because that's right. All the instrumentals. It's a lot of stuff.
That's a good tip. I think we might have to, you know, narrow it down a little bit.
Yeah.
So, okay, guys, if you have questions, drop them in that Q&A. We have now reached our final round. So it's really about to go down here. The final round is our speed round, and it is, of course, called Time's Up. So in this round, you will have 90 seconds in the category of your choosing to answer 5 non-multiple choice questions. Now, again, you got Frank. Look, Frank, you're in the passenger seat here. So, like,
hey.
I know you've been playing the coy, cryptic, like, you know, Yoda-isms. I think you got to just, you know, if you feel like, you know, Dan, with your permission, if this feels right, I think you guys got to tag team this here. You know, this is... Obviously, the chat is here. So let's look at our categories. And Dan, you get to choose your category for...
Okay.
Final round. The first round is called Chef's Kiss. Now, hold on. I should say this first and foremost. We're deviating a little bit here from the Dilla umbrella here. So, two of these categories are not Dilla related, and then one of them is. So, the first is Chef's Kiss. Obviously, you wrote a book called Work Clean, examining all about chefs. This is about chefs and culinary things in hip hop. The second category is 101 Things to Do While I'm Referencing Your Girl. This is all about songs that reference women in hip hop or girls in hip hop. And then finally, we have the One More Time for Dilla, which is a deep dive back into some more Dilla questions. So,
all right. So listen, since I'm tag teaming this with Frank, I want to give you the option. You pick the one that you're the most comfortable with, and that's the one we're going to roll with.
Well, see, here is that. That's a loaded option because Chef's Kiss is your thing, right? Like, that's a book. That's something you know, but I have no, I can't help you on that.
Right.
But to be fair, just to be fair, to clarify, the title is just referencing that this is all in the realm of hip hop. So it's all about
Chef's not about Anthony
kitchen.
Bourdain.
No,
yeah.
There's no.
Okay,
Bourdain.
Okay. I don't know. You, Dan, whatever you want. I got your back, bro. Whatever you want. I'm rolling with you.
You know what? Let's do 101 Things to Do While I'm Referencing Your Girl. Shout out to Quest the Mad Lad. Well, let's just get into it.
All right, we're going to get into it. So again, just to reiterate, we have 90 seconds, 5 non-multiple choice questions. If you don't know the answer, you could say pass and we'll come back to it. But if you answer incorrectly, then the question is burnt and you got it wrong. Although I will allow, since it's the two of you here, you both can get a try on it because right. I would hate for one of you to shout it out and the other is like, no, it was this. So, I have OC's classic instrumental for Time's Up here, and it is timed to 90 seconds. So when we stop hearing that beat, which will now probably cause us all to have a little bit of nightmares and jitters, when the beat runs out, your time is up. So we're doing 101 Things to Do While I'm Referencing Your Girl. That's the category. Mm-hmm. All right. Dan, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling okay.
He's feeling okay. He's feeling not that bad, which is the questions, you know, mantra. It's grandma. All right. 90 seconds on the clock. 101 Things to Do While I'm Referencing Your Girl. Dan Charnas with special guest and co-pilot Frank Nitt. Y'all ready to do this?
Yeah.
Here we go. According to Biz Markie's seminal hit, Just a Friend, how long did the song's subject want to make him wait before they could make love?
She wanted you to wait. Frank, you want to jump in?
I can't reference it.
Let me say, you wanted you to wait. We'll pass on that. We'll come back to it.
All right, we're going
to
pass. Okay.
Adam
Yauch used this Beastie Boys single to apologize for some of the treatment of women in earlier parts of songs in the group's catalog. What Beastie Boys single did he apologize to women on?
Oh, shoot. I stopped listening to Beastie Boys by that time. What, Frank, you got that?
No. Hands up. I don't know.
Pass.
All right. In 2007, this LA hip-hop native released a genre-crossing album called Songs About Girls.
Oh, wait a minute. Say that again.
This LA hip-hop native in 2007 released an album called Songs About Girls.
That's Will.i.am.
Will.i.am is correct. Okay. The chorus to Money Trees off Kendrick Lamar's Good Kid, Mad City references this actress.
Oh, Frank, do you know that one? You want to take
that? No. Go ahead.
I think it's Janet Jackson. Am I wrong?
It's Halle Berry.
I thought it was Halle Berry.
What is the name of the titular character in Mos Def's 1999 single, Ms. Fat Booty?
Frank.
Chat, help him out.
Chat, give me some. I'm referencing the wrong rap right now. I want to say Charisse, but that's not it.
Charisse is correct. Charisse
is correct. Okay.
We're putting that one in. What'd you say?
I was saying for the bit. Can I go back to the biz thing, or we lost it?
I'll let you do it because our time is up. So like this, I'll let you slide one last in.
I think it was a year.
A year is correct. We're giving it to you. Okay, so the one that you missed that we didn't go back to is the Beastie Boys song "Sure Shot." He basically said the disrespect to women is long overdue, and I want to apologize to all these women that we've talked a lot of shit about in our previous song. So it's maturity.
Better late than never.
Better late than never. Exactly. So Dan, we actually are calling a bit of an audible here because from what I understand, you have some trivia for me here.
I do. This is just three quick, sort of modeled on the questions, three quick Detroit the trivia questions. And, just want to sort of, because it's all about experiencing the D. I was lucky enough to go to the D in 1999. I was lucky enough to have it sort of be a second home for me because, my wife's family's from there. So we're going to do three quick questions for Sean, and Frank is going to be the judge. Are you ready?
Yes, and this is what I'm going to propose here.
Okay.
Because I'm fair, and I'm fair about these things. Mm-hmm. I want to say, for everyone that I do not get, that's going to be a point that gets added back to you. This is like, it's sort of like a balance here. Or are you're looking at me funny, like that's not a good idea. Do you not want this treatment? Or
I mean, I don't want to cheat. I don't want to steal points from you. I lost those points fair and square.
Okay. No, that's a fair point. Then let me total up your score really quick. Your score is 1, 2, 3. Wait, but while I do this, Dan, the question that I have to ask you that I ask everybody, and it's a great question, and it also is great because it stalls while I do math because I'm bad at it. Now that you've been on the show, who would you challenge or nominate to come on the questions next?
Oh, wow. Who do I know who hasn't been on the show? I feel like all my friends have been on the show. Darn, man. I'll tell you what, I'm gonna have the answer for you by the end of this program.
Okay.
Have you had Russell Peters on?
We have had Russell Peters on. Okay. He was one of our early ones, but we should have him back for sure. And now,
no, because he's a hip hop maniac. Yeah.
So Dan, I totaled up your score here. You took a little bit of a beating in the first and the final round. You had a strong middle, but you still walk away with a very respectable 11 out of 15. Now, let me tell you who sits in the 11 club with you. We've got Russell Peters, Speak of the Devil.
Hey.
Russell Peters scored 11. We've got DJ Mighty My, Diallo Riddle, Static Selecta, Salam Remy, El DeSensei, J Live, Chubb Rock, Lyrics Born, Mr. C, Kim Osorio from the Source fame of so many other things.
Mm-hmm.
The 11 club is not a bad place to be. I want you to know that
I'm not in it. Did you hear that? I'm not in it.
Frank Nitt is not in the 11 club. Frank is in, I'm doing some
probably like the four club.
No, Frank, you're in the 9 club. You're sitting with a bunch of people in the 9 club. So
okay.
Collectively, I think this boosts your score.
it made me think, like, I think the person I suggest should be another journalist. So it would be awesome to see, like, a great journalist like Jeff Chang in the seat if you haven't already had him in.
Have not had Jeff Chang, and would love to have him.
Or just Adam Mansbach, because he's such a smart ass. You know, you should put him right there, too. You know, because he read an early version of this book, and he came back with, like, 5,000 errors that I needed to clean up. And I'm glad that he did, believe it or not. But, you know, I want to see him. I want to see him right here. That's what I want.
Amazing. Yes. We have, again, shout out to the book, Dilla Time. We're going to be doing a little drawing towards the end of this here. But first, we're going to do something that I usually don't condone. I'm going to be put in the hot seat. Let's see how little I know about Detroit, a place that I've never been to.
All right. So first question here is, Detroit is divided into West and East sides. Which side of Detroit is J Dilla's neighborhood of Conant Gardens on? West side or East side?
I'm going to say, and there's no clever way about this because I'm either right or wrong. So there's not a lot of deducting here. I want to say, and I read the book. It was a while. I got an advanced copy. So I think things have faded a little bit. Is Conant Gardens on the west side of Detroit?
Frank?
No, sir. It would be on the east side of Detroit.
Damn, son.
All right.
All right. Second question. Name one Detroit dance. In other words, a kind of dance that came out of Detroit. The book mentions three of them. One of them in particular is very, you know, we spent a little time on one of them. And as a matter of fact, Derek Harvey, Dank, was very good at this. I'm sure Frank was. And I heard that James Yancey actually did this on his knees.
Yes, he did.
So, but anyone, any Detroit dance will do.
Am I? Okay. I want to say, and this is something that I've heard mentioned on the records a lot, but again, I don't have a lot of context here. Is the Earl Flynn a dance?
Yes.
Frank?
Yes.
Hey!
Not now.
Yes. You got it.
It's your boy. Yes. It's your boy.
Thanks, Jay.
All right.
It's that right there. It's the hand movement. It's the cool gangster dance. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. That's the Earl Flynn.
I can't do it while I'm holding a pen. I need to put this down. You know what? I'm not even going to desecrate a beloved Detroit dance. We're not going to do that.
So now this is my favorite one. This is our version of the lightning round for you.
Oh God!
This is what we played in Detroit Jeopardy when I took my NYU class, you know, my students to Detroit, you know, for the Dilla class. This is straight from that game. I'm going to hold up three Detroit geographic names, street names, or like neighborhood names, and you have to correctly pronounce them. Okay.
Oh, God.
Ready? Yep. Frank will tell you whether you did it or not. Here's the first one.
Gratiot?
It's close. It's close. It's Gratiot.
Gratiot.
Very good. It's almost close enough.
It was close. It was very close. It was very close. Right?
Gratiot.
Gratiot.
Okay. Now, next one.
Shane?
You got that right.
Okay. Hey, look at that.
This is what I'm doing. I'm just taking what I think it would be, and then I'm doing the opposite of what I would think it would be. Because
okay.
It's all right.
Last and final one.
Okay. Oh, this is a good one.
Hamtrak?
Oh, my God. It's Hamtramck. It's like a storied Polish neighborhood. City, actually. It's a lot of, and it's inside of Detroit. It's like bordered by Detroit all the way around.
Yep.
Well, I think that I obviously have some more studying to do, and maybe I need to make the actual, make my trip, my voyage out to the D at some point.
Hamtramck was funny.
You did great. You did
great. Yeah, you got two out of three. That was great.
Have you ever been to Detroit?
I haven't been to Michigan. Michigan is one of the few states that I've not been to, and I really need to. I really need to.
Every American should go to Detroit. Mm-hmm. If you want to know what makes this country tick, if you want to know what's great about it, and also the ways in which this country, sabotages itself, right? You know, Detroit is that place. That's why I took my students there. And that's why I love it. I just, it's, you know, Frank knows.
Yeah.
That's home.
Frank knows a thing or two about Detroit. Thank you for that. Dan Charnas, never invited back again on the question list. No, I learned something, and learning is important. We're going to go into a couple questions. Guys, I know we're running a little bit over. Can we do a couple questions from the chat? Are we all good? Yeah, I just want to make sure nothing's on the stovetop, or, you know, like you told somebody you're going to meet them outside or whatever. Okay. Now, let's see. We've got a question. Justin, we've got these coming in here. Okay. Let's see. Frank, how and when did you first hear the beat for McNasty Filth? And did you just lose your shit when you heard it?
Actually, that's an interesting story. No. Not that the beat wasn't dope, but McNasty Filth was kind of one of the last beats we heard. We were at Dilla studio, his home studio in Clinton Township, and he had this batch of Mad Lib beats. And if anybody knows about how Mad Lib sends beats, like, I've personally got 300 beats at one time from him, right? To go through to record songs, right?
That's like a lot of work.
Well, I mean, but you know, it's a lot of good too. Mad Lib's incredible. So what you gonna do, right? So. Right. We're going through these beats, and we had been there for a good little while, and there was so many beats that we, you know, where the whole room would light up when the beat came on, just woo, right? But by the time we got down to McNasty Filth playing, it was dope, head nod, but we was kind of, you know, out of spark. And Dilla being, you know, who he is, especially in the capacity of Frank-N-Dank and how our music working relationship was, he's like, oh, no, this the beat right here. Because he didn't see the enthusiasm, right? So now I'm gonna make it a challenge for y'all. And at that point, I recorded Frank-N-Dank's vocals. Like Dilla would give us the beat, get the beat put up, and then I would record the vocals, and then he would mix songs, or if he's gonna add vocals, whatever, he'd do that the next day. So this was pretty much status quo. He gave us the beat. And again, because we didn't say "woo" when it came on, was the reason he picked this beat. Right, it wasn't because we had went woo on earlier beats, is what I'm saying. It was because we didn't do that for this particular one. So he said, okay, this is what it is. So y'all got to figure out what y'all gonna rhyme to that, right? So he puts up the beat and goes upstairs. And throughout the night, he's upstairs, you know, sleeping, eating, whatever it is he's doing. We record our vocals. And when I tell you, he came downstairs in the morning, usual routine with the blunt. Y'all got something for this? Yeah, it's already recorded. Check it out. He plays it. And he listened, and he was like, this what y'all wrote? Oh, yeah. He put us out the studio because now he had to finish the song because he didn't expect us to finish the song. So we went and we did all our parts, and we had, you know, all the different pieces that you hear of Frank-N-Dank on there already. And he had to go and do all his parts after. He didn't think we was going to do it. And he didn't think he was going to have to do the work. But when he woke up that morning and we had all these pieces done for McNasty Filth, he was just like, yo, y'all did all this? All right, time to get out. Everybody, y'all get out, man. It's time. I got to go to work. And he had to finish that song. So McNasty Filth was one of those joints where it was an actual story. It wasn't just, oh, that's right. Dope beat. We rap into it. You know what I'm saying? No, it was a whole story behind it. You know what I mean?
You know what I love about that beat too? I was just making the case the other day to a colleague of mine about the merits of J Dilla as the MC. And I pointed to that song because the thing that's crazy about that song, I didn't even necessarily notice it until I listened to it a few times. His cadence is mirroring the little shaker.
I mean,
the hi-hat through the whole song. If you go back and listen to it, the cadence of his rhymes mirrors that crazy hi-hat. That
I'll give Frank-N-Dank all the credit for that.
Yeah,
because he didn't expect us to finish that song. And he hadn't planned on writing to it. When we did it, he said, okay, now I'm gonna kill these guys now. And then he went, yeah.
I got a question for Frank, actually. This is like a fan question. How did you and Dank come up with the alphabet soup idea for pause, you know, where you had the spelling out and then you, like, how did that originate? How did you both decide you were going to do that?
You know what? It really wasn't. It was my initial idea was to do that. I had the idea of it, right? And I wanted Dank to do his name in the second verse. Mm. I'm gonna do Frank in the first verse, and I was gonna figure out how to do "and" for the chorus, right? That was the initial plan. But Dank said, "I don't want to do that. I got my own thing."
Right.
So I just condensed my idea into my whole verse and spelled out Frank-N-Dank throughout my whole verse.
Incredible.
So that's where it came from.
That's one of my favorite from all of Dilla's, you know, body of work. That's one of my favorite verses.
Love it.
Period. Like, just great.
Yeah, that beat was made 15 minutes, bro.
Wow.
And the penthouse suite on top of your mom's crib, that's a real thing.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No, the house is not there anymore. But upstairs in my mother's crib, I had two rooms. I had like a lounge room, like a living room kind of, and then my bedroom. So that was the spot. Everybody would pull up, would go upstairs, video games, weed, and whatever. Up above, all the smoke went up and out the windows. Yeah. Didn't bother Mom Dukes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And that was the spot. Like, you know, a lot of people been there. Talib and all types of people been to the penthouse suite. You know what I'm saying? Like, so.
Yeah, because you reference all the chicks. So I'm wondering if there's a rough number on that.
Oh, no. A
rough draft, if you will.
No. There's no rough draft on that. There's no record of that. There's no type of paperwork, pictures. Right. This is pre-internet. So all that is confidential.
It was different time. We have a question for Dan. Dan, I think this is a good question. Somebody from the chat asks, was Dilla's mom concerned with how honest the book is? This reader is halfway through, so maybe that gets answered. But, you know, I would say that the Dilla time is very fair in that it very much gets a lot of different people's input and really depicts everybody for all of their, you know, merits, as well as, you know, the human, you know, quality of the fact that, you know, nobody's perfect. There were a lot of decisions made and things. So was there any concern amongst Ma Dukes or other people who you interviewed for this book about you really kind of taking a very hard journalistic stance?
Right. Well, you know, what I tried to do is take an empathetic journalistic stance. Like, everybody gets to be human in this book. And as far as Maureen Yancey Smith is concerned, this is a direct quote from Maureen. She says, "I'm going to give you the real. I'm going to give you the real." And there were some difficult things that I had to run by her. And she's like, you know, if it happened, she's like, you know, yes, that it happened. And if she disagreed with somebody else, another character in the book, if they had different reflections of what the truth was, then I left it on the page for the reader to understand that there's a dispute, that there's a conflict. And I just hope that the reader comes away with the sense of the humanity of every person in this book. But, you know, to answer the question, you know, she said, I'm going to give you the real. And I think she did.
I love that. Love that. Yeah. And you put it way more articulately than I did, which is, I think it really does capture the humanity of everybody involved and depicts an honest and fair depiction of everybody. So, okay. We have reached the end here, and we have selected our winner at random. Hmm. So going into our chat here, Derek Dantzler. Derek Dantzler is selected as the winner of a copy of the Dilla Time book. It's going to be autographed by our author and special guest, Dan, here. He's got the Sharpie ready. We're obviously not lying to you. If we were, why would he have that Sharpie there? He's going to sign it. So Derek, I don't know if we can reach out to him on the chat here or how that works, but send us your contact info or we'll work it out. Justin, let me know if there's a way that we can, make sure that we do that. He'll have it. Okay. We've got it. Yes. It's all taken care of. Again, live producing, live tech, live troubleshoot. First time on Hopin. Dan and Frank, this was so much fun. And I gotta be honest, We went about 90 minutes. I could easily go another 90, but I want to be respectful of, you know, your time and everybody else's time. But thank you so much for taking part in this, both, you know, for all of the ways that you guys are helping to honor and bring light to the legacy and the wonderful work of one of the greatest musicians of our time. I mean, it's incredible to have you both here. And yeah, I really appreciate you guys taking the time.
Thank you, Sean, for making a platform for that. And Frank, man, just it's surreal to be able to even be on a platform with you. Yeah. Just thank you so much, man. Thank you for everything.
Well, Sean, you know, of course, thank you for having me. You always do. I'm sure I'll be back again. And Dan, you know, you the man. Dan the man right now. And, you know, I appreciate you for allowing me to be involved and to be a you know, just a face in this whole thing, in this whole movie we got going on. I appreciate that part because, you know, I rep for my guy. So you see, and just in case y'all don't, there you go right there all the time.
There it
right?
is.
So, yeah, you know, I appreciate y'all. Sean, you know, you're my guy, dog. You know, so I appreciate y'all. The questions, all the folks out there, everything, man.
Yeah, shout out to everybody who watched and you know, shout out to the good folks at Hopin for putting this together, as well as Fusicology, Dilla Fest, Dilla Week. You know, we're in it now. Like we're in the midst of it. So you know, you guys have any plugs or anything you want to shout out to people, what they can look for from you guys, Dan?
Well, tomorrow at I think 5 p.m. And I'm doing a great talk with somebody who I consider one of the very first journalists to cover the J Dilla Slum Village story. And that's Kelly L. Carter, who used to write for the Detroit Free Press. Before that, she actually went to, like, she's a Detroit native. And she covered, you know, Detroit hip hop before James passed. And then she played a big role in covering the aftermath of his passing. And she's just a great legendary reporter, and I'm looking forward to having a nice talk reporter to reporter with her. You can find that information on my Twitter page. If you click events, you'll see how you can get in.
Nice.
Wonderful. And Frank, anything that we can look out for from you or for Dilla Week or
Dilla Week, check this out. New hoodies. New Ooh. Fire J Dilla hoodies. Yes, sir.
I need one of those.
DeliciousVinyl.com, you know, I got you. DeliciousVinyl.com, you can get the new hoodies and, you know, a plethora of other Dilla merch, you know, hats, masks, t-shirts, all the good stuff. Musically, my new record, Serene OG, it's an album full length produced by King Michael Coy, Grammy nominated, super producer. It's in stores right now, y'all can go get that. And, you know, we got some other Dilla events coming up. I think I'm going to Arizona next week. So there's a few things going on, Detroit at some point. So, you know, we in full on Dilla month at this point. So
yeah,
it's always
Dilla month. Amazing. Yeah. Check us out. Questionshiphop.com. We're going to be doing more, you know, shows on Hopin now. This is a really cool platform that we're really happy to be using. And I love it. And we have a couple of versus battles, like not versus in the traditional sense, but we've got some hip hop face-offs that are going to be happening soon. So nice. I can't reveal much, but it's going to be fun. And we might be seeing some former guests of the show come back to, you know, duke it out in the ring with each other. So I'll have to stay tuned for that. But thank you so much, everybody, for watching. And we will see you real soon. And yeah, I'll have to make the voyage to Detroit soon so I can learn to pronounce all these street names.
That's
right. We'll get you some Coney Island. Yeah,
there you go.
All right. Thanks, y'all. See you next time.
Peace.